The Y Curve with Phil Dobby and Roger Hearing.
Tax cuts or tax rises?
Jeremy Hunt's autumn statement claimed to reduce the burden on grafters. But overall, we're still paying the most tax since the Second World War.
And there's worse news, higher inflation than expected next year and lower growth.
The One Plus, the Treasury's coffers are growing faster as a result of inflation and more people being dragged into higher tax.
But don't expect public spending to keep up with inflation in some areas. It looks like another round of austerity.
So is this prudent housekeeping with some sensible stimulus?
Or a naked bid to win next year's election?
The Y Curve.
Well, I mean, clearly they have no chance of winning next year's election.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So they can try, but it's not going to work.
It's how badly they lose, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe.
Could be that. But no, I mean, you know, there is a. Is this just what it seems to be, which is laying out the ground? I mean, the very fact that a lot of the change is coming on January the 6th rather than the end of the tax year, it makes you wonder, doesn't it?
Well, I didn't see a great deal of structure in it. You know, it's like we were told, it's almost like by saying there's 110 different items here, it's almost like you're never going to get your head around this. Don't worry about it. But tell you what, we'll give you a 2% cut to national insurance just so you feel like there's something good going on, but all the rest of it's far too complicated for you, the general proletariat, to understand.
110 measures and all this. Yes, it's crazy stuff. No, you're right. I mean, there didn't seem to be much there. It was headlinable stuff. And even, you know, it's interesting, the papers seem divided on whether they want to just highlight the fact, oh, it's the biggest tax-cutting thing, or the fact that there's this enormous tax burden.
Well, look, there's a lot to talk about in all of this, so let's talk to somebody who knows all about
it. The man who has advised us before, Simon French, who's chief economist and head of research at Panmure Gordon. He joins us now.
So, Simon, supposedly 110 measures. Has anyone actually figured out what those 110 are? I mean, there's obviously one or two big hitters, but there's only one, really, isn't there, which is the, you know, cut to national insurance. But 110, have
That's
you counted
lot.
Them?
Well, the law of big numbers. I think Jeremy Hunt, if I recall, threatened to read them all out, and there was nervous laughter in the chamber during the autumn statement that he might actually follow through with that threat. I haven't actually managed to go through all of them. There's so much supporting documentation at an autumn statement or a budget. It takes days. It'll be this weekend's work to go through all of it. But I think it illustrates, doesn't it, the pretty bipartisan view that the supply side of the UK economy is, if not broken, it's severely holed beneath the waterline and needs a lot of repair across a multitude of sectors. And you're right, national insurance to cuts to try and improve work incentives, and of course full expensing made permanent to try and improve investment incentives. And I think if you're looking at long dated problems with the UK's supply response, that underinvestment is where the UK benchmarks really badly over a multi-decade view compared to its G7 competitors.
But is this going to fix? Is that going
to
mean?
Well, and is this actually not really something that's looking to the long term, despite everything the government says and Rishi Sunak says? This is essentially preparing for an election, isn't it? That's what it sounds like.
And yeah, because the fact that it's all kicking in. Well, yeah, but it's all kicking in January rather than the beginning of next financial year. I mean, that surely says there's going to be an election before then.
Well, you could take a different view, which is let's just take a different view for the purposes of debate. I probably share some of your political cynicism, but we have heard this morning of this recording that the energy price cap in the UK goes up 5% this winter. Now, if you take also into account the subsidy that was available for households last winter that isn't available this winter, actually the amount that households will be spending on energy is probably going to be higher this winter than last winter. And so the Chancellor might conceivably, if he was joining us on this podcast, say, look, there's still a very significant cost of living squeeze. I don't want to wait till April to hand improvements in take-home pay to UK workers.
Yeah, well, thank goodness he's not, because he might threaten to do those 110 policy measures. We'd never get him out of here. But if this fiscal headroom, it's an interesting term, isn't it, that all of a sudden has emerged, because the position is better than we thought. If he's worried about government debt, and he clearly is, why would he just not just say, well, that's a bit of a, you know, we'll just use that to draw down the debt? Why did he have to feel the need to spend it?
I think because the UK economy still has some quite significant growth challenges. We do not see growth going back to anything like trend for 2 to 3 years. And partly that's an adjustment to higher cost of capital, higher interest rates for the household and corporate sector, but partly because there is some quite significant damage from the adjustment to both Brexit and the pandemic. And those two factors mean that any additional headroom, which is always, you're right, it's always an artificial construct based on somewhat arbitrary fiscal rules, but whatever headroom there is, I think the current economic and, of course, political climate means that that is more likely to be spent than, if you like, banked. But, you know, a lack of fiscal discipline is not a uniquely British problem. One only needs to look across the Atlantic to some of the budgetary debate going on in the United States to realise there are no votes currently. There's no economic dividend to be yielded by talking about balanced budgets at the moment.
But the point, I suppose, which has come out of this more than anything else, is the headline claim, this is a tax-cutting budget. That's all, tax-cutting statement. That is what is being put out there.
And yet
the balance of saying we are more heavily taxed now than we have been in 75 years overall. How can one square any of that?
And also, you know, the conversation we've been having, or he's been having, saying that, you know, we can't cut taxes because we've got to make sure that inflation doesn't kick back in again. And, you know, just this week, Andrew Bailey, in front of the Treasury Select Committee, said he's worried about the persistence of inflation. And one of the reasons was services prices. In other words, you know, services inflation. If we've got supposedly more money in our pockets, aren't we going to go out and spend it? And isn't that going to make that situation worse?
Well, two huge questions there. I'll take each in turn. So to Rogers on the, what I would describe the pithy phrase of the tyranny of marginal changes. So how can those both these statements be true, that it's a tax cutting autumn statement, which it is, and the tax burden is going to the highest level since the Second World War? Also true. Well, the marginal change of the autumn statement was to reduce the tax burden from what we thought it was going to be before the autumn statement. But those decisions made before the autumn statement will take the tax burden to 38%, which is the highest it's been since the Second World War. So they are consistent statements. And I note the front page of the FT and the Times today took very different stances to exactly the same statement, if you like, illustrating the confusion. By the way, similar story on growth. Growth estimates were downgraded, but actually the size of the UK economy was upgraded versus what the OBR said in March. So further confusions in terms of the interpretation. And then on to the even bigger question of tax cuts at a time when we're still worried about inflation. And clearly memories don't need to go back too far to remember the worries that stalked the mini budget just over a year ago from Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng on similar supply side efforts, fiscal stimulus that spooked sterling and gilt markets. A couple of things to say. First of all, we're in a different backdrop. While Andrew Bailey is right to be cautious, it's partly self-serving to be cautious, of course. He doesn't want financial conditions to loosen. But inflation is falling, and it's falling very rapidly now, which is very different to 12 months ago when it was rising very rapidly. So investors are more sanguine. And that's just, I mean, it's not Liz Truss's fault that she took office. That is probably the only thing that wasn't her fault.
I was going to say, that's not a long list, is it?
No, it's not. But it wasn't her fault. But the timing was poor. And therefore, a similar prognosis trying to address the supply side gets a very different response when the economic backdrop is different. Mm. But also, perhaps going into the sort of the details of these reforms, you're right. Aggregate demand is increased by indexing universal credit, indexing the triple lock pension well above the rate of inflation, and by cutting payroll taxes to the self-employed and to payway workers. But the way the OBR looked at it was that the Office of Budget Responsibility, that is that the supply response from the economy in terms of more workers presenting themselves for work and greater investment from businesses should offset that. Now, if that doesn't come through, then yes, it will be inflationary. But I do think we get ourselves in a bit of a doom loop if we don't think that anything can impact the supply side of the economy. So I think I'm prepared to go with, and certainly market response seems to be prepared to go with the Chancellor on this one.
How reliable are, we talk about the OBR figures, and of course, notoriously.
I just answer that before you even finish the question? Not at all.
Okay.
I mean, the fact that those numbers change so much from March to this latest set of numbers shows that they really don't have a strong handle on what's going on, do they?
Whether it's the OBR's fault or whether that's the ONS, the Office for National Statistics fault, one of the reasons why there was this, if you like, dichotomy between slower growth but a larger economy was because the ONS upgraded the UK's growth performance since the bottoming out of the pandemic in a very poorly timed release, and the last Friday of the summer holidays in August, finding a spare £38 billion down the back of the sofa. I wish I found £38 billion down the back of the sofa. I've got two young kids, so all I find is sticky sweets. But
worth a look, though, Simon. You never know.
Worth a look, definitely worth a look. But the ONS were, if you like, bequeathing the OBR with a larger estimate for the economy. So I wouldn't pitch all the blame on the OBR on this particular juncture, although, as I've written about this morning to clients, some of the cynicism I do have with the OBR is their constant underestimation of how much labour market participation there has been in the UK economy for the last 13 years. Systematically very bearish, very pessimistic, and actually, each and every time, the UK economy has performed rather better on participation than the OBR.
And yet we're still told, aren't we, 400,000 more people since the pandemic who are of working age, who are economically inactive, which is why Jeremy Hunt is saying, you know, we're signing off so many people into benefits with no requirement that they look for work, whether they're sick or disabled. It's the potential is wrong economically and morally, he said. So the moral answer is that people who are sick should go back to work. But get driving disabled people into work,
Marginal. I mean, none of that's really, I mean, it more than moral case.
Is it actually going to make, is it just a pipe dream for it to happen anyway?
Well, so look, it's such a dangerous territory for economists to get
absolutely.
Absolutely. But
we're taking you there.
Well, you are taking me there, and I'm gonna take the dangerous invite. I will try and be brave. But we know that the spike you talk about, 400,000 people on the list of people who are sick and disabled, were relatively recently either seeking work or in work. So I began my career more than 20 years ago now as a labour market economist in the DWP working on such issues. And we know when people have a recent attachment to the labour market, then interventions, which are always partly carrot and partly stick, and there are both in the recent government statements on this, Mel Stride's reform plan to try and get people back to work has a bit of both. We know that people who've been recently attached to the labour market, the route back is slightly easier than those who've been sick and disabled perhaps their whole life or for long periods of time. So I think it's why a relatively rapid response to this big spike has a better chance of success than perhaps if, you know, there is always going to be a cohort of people who are unable to work, and even compositional changes of remote working from home will really not eat much into that cohort of people who are probably not going to be work ready. But it's those who are on the margins where interventions, I think, have a track record of more success.
But is it really going to make that much difference?
Very small numbers, relatively speaking. We're not really thinking that the army of the unwilling and the disabled pushed back onto the shop floor is actually going to turn the economy around. That's nonsense.
And isn't the issue, real issue, productivity, which is, you know, those who are working, how hard are they? I couldn't agree
with you more that the real issue is productivity. But I don't think it's quite right to say that, you know, reducing inactivity can't make a contribution. Of course, we have 8.7 million people of working age in activity at the moment. But that was north of 9 million in the aftermath of the pandemic. It was north of 9 million back in 2012. And a succession of, you know, quiet, steady supply-side reforms have in the past brought that down. we can always debate, and we'll never get the right answer, but we can always debate on the right ratio of carrot and stick to make that happen. But I think to write this group off as not warranting attention to try and encourage them back into the workforce, I think is wrong. To the second point on productivity, absolutely right. And we are going to be in this debate for every fiscal event, as far as the eye can see, if we don't nail the issue of public sector productivity particularly. It's not great in the private sector, but in the public sector, it is dire. Since 1997, public sector productivity has gone up by less than 5%.
Well, can we define what we mean by public sector productivity in that way? In basic terms, what is not happening that should be in what way?
Well, we continue to put in a lot of money into the public sector, and the public sector's outputs are broadly linear to the inputs put in, which is no productivity growth at all. You get a pound, you put a pound of inputs in, you get a pound of outputs out. Now, of course, the beauty, the secret sauce in economics is to put in a pound and get maybe a pound and two out a year later, or, you know, that is what productivity growth is. It is producing more with the same, or the same with less. We are not getting that systematically under governments of different colours for 25 years in the public sector. And if you look at the funding squeeze now penciled in for the other side of the general election, whoever is in charge in the Treasury, whether it's Jeremy Hunt, Rachel Reeves, or someone else, could be Nigel Farage if he successfully makes it out of the jungle, they will have this particular challenge, because constantly putting money into public services with no productivity uplift will mean that aforementioned tax burden, the highest since 1945, will continue to rise.
And isn't part of that the relating to how that money is being spent, though? So, for example, just that argument that, you know, that whole multiplier effect, that if you've got government money and the government money is put into investing in something which is going to grow and help build the economy, that's fine, versus putting money into paying teachers or paying doctors and nurses providing a service, which is not the same sort of investment, is it? And yet so we're cutting back on the first sort of investment, but we're seeing more, an aging population and greater demands to be spent on the health service, then of course we're going to see productivity decline.
Yeah, I think you make a good point, which is that we sometimes look at investment in human capital as different to investment in physical capital, but they're all part of what is known as total factor productivity. So we need to focus on both. The question is whether the answer to this is more money or more reform. Now, if again, we invited Jeremy Hunt on the podcast, if we invited the Prime Minister, we went up the pay grade even further, we invited the Prime Minister onto the podcast, he would say, I'm excited by AI. He's excited by everything, isn't he, in the technology sphere. But he's excited by the potential of AI, artificial intelligence, to make a significant impact in the delivery of public services. You think about the large clerical, paper-based, repetitive roles that make up quite a large proportion of the 5.7 million public sector roles, then there's the opportunity. But my criticism on what I was generally quite positive about the autumn statement, my criticism was what I thought was a pretty deafening silence on public sector productivity and translating excitable words on AI, or Francis Maud's recent review, or Lord Maud's recent review on governance in the civil service. All these, the recent back to the office edict for civil servants, all of those things don't translate into a plan to actually get more out of the inputs you put into the
public. Because if you spend on the public sector in terms of putting in investment, for example, in AI, that is initially going to cost money, that's just not something, again, politically, that's greatly acceptable at the moment.
But it's a bit nebulous as well, isn't it? Everyone's trying to figure out what the impact of AI is really going to be. But I can see your point about the public sector, but isn't it really the private sector where we want to see a lot of that growth coming from? So I looked at those OBR numbers. I might be reading it wrong, but next year it looks like 0.7% growth in GDP, which is a lot better than they were forecasting back in February, but a 5.6% fall in fixed investment by business. And a lot of the growth is coming from a 4% increase in government consumption. So it's the public sector that's fueling that growth, but it's not real growth, is it? I mean, we want the real growth in GDP to come from the private sector, and they're saying we're not going to be investing too much because we don't think the outlook's looking too good.
You make a very fair point, and one of the reasons why the growth outlook is pretty challenging, and not just in the UK but globally, and that includes now the United States, which has defied economic gravity for the last 2 or 3 years. One of the reasons is that there is an adjustment to be taking place to higher interest rates. And of course, in the investment landscape, that raises the hurdle rate for new investment. Mm. Now, any economist worth their salt would say if you raise the hurdle rate, largely outside the control of the government, the spike in inflation that has led to higher interest rates, you will get less investment. So some of the exhaust pipe data you're referring to is a result of the fact that the cost of capital for companies looking to invest has gone up 3-4-fold over the last 2 years. And it's incongruous to think there wouldn't be a response to in terms of investment.
Yeah. And that coupled with the fact that they'll be saying, well, you know, we want to see the growth in the economy before we invest. I mean, that's, you know, interest rates obviously are important.
Well, I think that is the key, because, I mean, that's the one thing we haven't really mentioned, the thing that's outside the government control, what the Bank of England is going to be doing, how it sees its position, perhaps vis-a-vis the Fed and numerous other central banks, and going forward, how they interpret inflation. And that is so big a factor and so totally outside anything that Jeremy Hunt can really control at all.
No. The government reduced inflation. Don't you remember?
Oh, did they? Oh, that's right. You're right.
Yeah. Nothing to do with the Bank of England.
I can see where you're leading me, and you're right, of course, which is the government deserves very little of the credit for bringing down inflation in the UK. But it also deserved very little of the criticism that it got on the ramp up of inflation. And I can understand why ministers from the PM downwards go, hang on, guys, we took all the flack that it was our fault on the way up, and you're now telling us we can't take any of the credit on the way down. It feels a bit asymmetrical. So I have some sympathy. My diagnosis is government was relatively little to blame on the way up, and it's relatively worth rewarding or praising it on the way down. But that's not how politicians have seen the blame and the reward game playing out.
So let's go back to the tax, and let me get into full cynic mode now. So universal credit rose by 6.7%. It rose by 10%, didn't it, earlier in the year? So it's sort of keeping in line with inflation. So that's good. State pension rises by more than inflation, 8.5%, but it's triple locked. And just by coincidence, 45% of those aged 65 plus intend to vote Conservative the next election versus 8% of 18 to 24-year-olds. So
those statistics are they might be out of date, actually, but yes.
You think it's more.
I think fewer and fewer, even of the pensioners, want to vote Tory, but anyway,
there's the opportunity. Let's hang on to the core vote. That says the cynic, not me, just throwing it out there. But why wouldn't you, why 2% on national insurance? Why wouldn't you be there saying, well, hang on, we've got this freeze in tax thresholds until 2027, 28. I mean, as every year goes by, we're all going to have less money to spend. There's going to be less money in the economy helping with that growth. Surely the sensible approach would be to say, well, if we've got this fiscal headroom, let's unlock that freeze that we've got on tax thresholds. Now, I can see that is harder to sell than a 2% cut now, because that's an easy message you can get across in the media. But if everyone was smart enough to figure it out, surely we'd be better off to say, well, actually, let's allow those thresholds to move in line with inflation, wouldn't we?
Yes. I mean, we must. There's a couple of things there. One is national insurance. The decision to go with national insurance, again, would be intellectually justified by trying to reward work, whereas income tax reductions, either by unfreezing the thresholds or changing the marginal rate, rewards also income from other sources, non-work sources, returns from capital, returns from savings, etc. And so I think I'm happy from a sort of, you know, trying to reward work in preference to rewards from other forms with the choice of national insurance. But then also, we've talked about earlier in the podcast, the fact that, you know, you still got to be careful of the inflationary impulse that could happen here. And fiscal drag, while unpopular, is if you like, performing a role in making sure the domestic demand doesn't contribute too much to that.
And I guess reducing VAT, which would be another way, would be just would be driving consumption, wouldn't it? So you would
that would be directly inflationary potentially.
Yeah, and also structurally. I mean, I think we know that the UK overconsumes and underinvests. So a VAT cut doesn't feel like the right prognosis. Mm. VAT reform, by all means. We have a we should be broadening the base of VAT and perhaps compensating by cutting the marginal rate. So the overall take is about the same, but becomes a more efficient tax. You look around a tax, and there's still plenty of opportunities to reform taxes. I mean, one of the things that was spoken about and didn't happen was inheritance tax reform. Yeah. Actually, slashing and burning inheritance tax is probably not a very smart move, but actually reforming it to lower the rate, but also limiting the amount that could be pumped into assets that are effectively tax avoidance schemes, farmland, unproductive business assets, etc. That those are kind of good reforms. That there's still a long list of things the government could be doing without sort of tinkering around with marginal
rates.
But
that was obviously politically unpalatable, wasn't it? Because clearly they were looking at that. They threw it out there to try and test the water, and then it came back with everyone saying, "Hang on, that's helping whatever small percentage it is that are actually paying this."
Which brings us back to the idea that this is in fact a whole statement that is intended for one purpose, really, which is to make things look reasonably good in the opening.
Back to the cynic.
I mean, it's what everything you're saying makes it seem that way.
Well, do you remember Norman Lamont? He cut taxes, didn't he, before the 1992 general election, on the basis that if they lost, which they won, well, he reversed the taxes. He reversed the tax cut shortly afterwards.
Look, these are politicians, so I'm not going to try and pretend that they don't have one and a half eyes on the political cycle. But I look across at the various, tax reforms we heard yesterday, and I thought, actually, given how expensive full expensing is, when you score it in the autumn statement scorecard, full expensing is not going to win any votes for the next general election. It really is. If you wanted to devote that kind of money to, shamelessly pursuing votes, you would have cut VAT, or you would have done something a bit more pollsters call a retail offer on tax. So the fact that they didn't surely has to lean in a little bit to your cynicism.
You're going back to your positivism, I'm afraid.
I know this was
a mini budget, wasn't it? So it's not a time for big tax reform. But you mentioned, reforms to inheritance tax. I mean, the idea of having a national insurance, the question is, wouldn't it be sensible actually just to abolish that and just integrate that into a fairer
That's a much
income
more
tax
structured
system? I mean, there's lots of structural change that's needed. And then on VAT, so I went and got my haircut yesterday and went to my... this is going off at an angle,
I'll bring it back.
It's barely noticeable, I have to say,
I went to get my haircut. I take a photograph of Roger and said, can I have a haircut just like this?
Well, everyone does.
And he says, would you like the pension discount as well, if you want to look like that? But this guy runs a barber shop. He gets... he basically says he could grow further, but he doesn't. And I think this happens for a lot of businesses because he doesn't pay VAT. He's 80, right on the 85,000, 80 or 85,000, whatever it is, threshold. And he doesn't want to grow the business anymore. I said, if you could get over that. And he says, but I can't because they have to charge, 20% more or however it's going to work out. And I'm already the most expensive, barbers there are in town. So he'd lose business because of it. And I'm saying, but if you got over that, you could be five times the size. And he says, yes, he'd like that, but this is an obstacle he just can't get over. Loads of small businesses in that boat. So if you want to increase productivity, if you want to get businesses working harder, get rid of that threshold.
I mean, I go to the barbers and talk about whether Liverpool or Man United are going to win.
You have a more interesting life, I think.
I tell you what, I do not talk about VAT thresholds, but I doff my cap to you, sir, for doing that. But you are absolutely right that there are. And it is on the VAT thresholds. There's also some very, very strange marginal tax rates in income tax.
You get over 100,000 and you're basically paying 60%.
Child benefit gets withdrawn as student loan repayments kick in. Yeah. There is plenty of tax simplification hiding in plain sight for the true reformist chancellor out there. And is it Jeremy Hunt? When economic conditions calm down, will it be Rachel Reeves if she takes office? Look, we are crying out for a tax reformist first chancellor. But it doesn't set the pulses racing, certainly not 12 months out from the election.
Yeah, and that's what they need. That's what they need to do. Well, look, as we move towards the end of the summer, let's get a sense of where you think, in a more general sense, the UK economy is going, because we had those figures from OBR, and we said they are at least questionable on the basis of their previous record. But do you get the sense that broadly their prognosis now for the 24-25 is right?
Yeah, more right than the Bank of England. So, look, I'm not going to celebrate my own forecasting too much, because my next forecasting failure will be along shortly. It comes with the territory with being an economic forecaster. But last year, when the Bank of England and indeed the OBR saw a quite pronounced recession in the UK, I took a different view, given the underlying health of UK household balance sheets. And we have avoided thus far a recession. And the fact that the bank now see no growth for the next 12 months, the OBR see 0.7% growth, I, for what it's worth, see 1.25% growth. I mean, none of those estimates are for hanging out the bunting. But I do think that in an environment where nominal income is going to go up between 6 and 7%, and inflation will be tacking below 4% in the new year, it's difficult for me to see no growth in the economy, even with all the various geopolitical headwinds that are swirling around and the sort of exhaustion of the excess savings post-pandemic, which has propped up the economy. But overall, do I see modest growth through the next 12, 18 months? Yes, I do. And if you'd offered people modest growth 12, 18 months ago, when Andrew Bailey, the governor of the Bank of England, described the outlook as apocalyptic, then I think most people would, they might not admit it this morning, but most people would have bitten your arm off.
I just wonder about those tax thresholds having a bigger impact than you're thinking, though, because on the sample of one, I just look at how much I think I'm going to be spending next year and the year after. And, my biggest client pays me. It's a CPI linked payment. So I know the amount of money I'm earning is going to go up, but the amount I'm going to spend relatively is going to go down, because I don't want to get over that tax threshold where I start paying 60% tax. Mm. So I'm putting it into my pension funds, which
your hair is going to be cut less often.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, I'm not invited back.
I hope you're buying
not
UK mid cap stocks, not just pumping it into Nvidia.
No.
But I mean, it's whichever way, it's money going, whichever way, it's money that's going into the finance sector rather than to the real economy, isn't it? So it's not helping growth a great deal, is it?
Well, it depends which fund it's going into. This is one of the frustrations I from the autumn statement was, the moment the UK tax system heavily incentivizes savers to back US technology companies. Mm. And I'm not clear with the Inflation Reduction Act and the CHIPS Act that the taxpayer money should be used to encourage a lower cost of capital for those US tech giants.
Good point.
There was very little to try and encourage the funneling of investment into UK growth companies. And that, I did think, was a black mark against what otherwise was a decent autumn statement.
So again, isn't it gets down to that question of tax reform and will it ever come from Jeremy Hunt?
Not the side of an election, I think, is going to be the truth of that.
Yeah.
Which was spot on.
Yeah.
Simon, thank you.
Great to talk again, Simon.
My pleasure. Great to join you.
There we are, a sense of, we haven't really got very far in economic terms.
He was on form, though, today.
He was, he was.
It's always good to talk.
And the haircutting issue is clearly one we'll come back to.
Well, yeah, I mean, my barber will be delighted to have made the cut.
A little bit of promotion.
Podcast. Yeah,
we'll put a link at the bottom of the podcast.
He has invited me not to come back again, though, because I bore the pants off him. But anyway.
I'm not sure.
Now, next week.
Yes, well, the forgotten war is what we're going to be talking about, because while we've, for obviously good reasons, everyone's been thinking about what's been going on in Gaza, nonetheless, there was that war that we've been talking about seemingly endlessly for, gosh, almost 2 years now.
Shows how fickle we are, because it's still raging on.
And Ukraine and Russia are still fighting each other. People are dying every day. Where are we with any of this? I mean, when we last tuned in, what was the situation? What is it now? And is the fact that it's got into what many people are describing as a stalemate actually a kind of victory for Vladimir Putin?
Yeah, and what are the consequences of that?
We will.
If that was the case.
All
we
will dig into all that next week.
On the Y Curve. See you next week. Thanks for listening.
Bye.
The Y Curve.